Hello, everyone, and welcome to this Brennan Center for Justice event. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, the Brennan Center is a nonpartisan law and policy institute that works to repair, to revitalize, and when necessary, to defend our democracy. My name is Troy McKenzie. I am the Cecilia Getz Professor of Law here at NYU. I am also the Dean at NYU Law. We are very excited to have you joining us today. But before we get started, just a few housekeeping notes. First, we are definitely going to leave time for questions at the end of this discussion. If you have a question that you would like to ask, please, please feel free to add it via YouTube or Facebook chat. Second, we value civility here at the Brennan Center. Those of you who post rude or intemperate language in our message streams, those messages are going to be removed from the conversation. And live closed captioning will also be provided during this event. You should also feel free to follow along with the conversation on social media with the hashtag Brennan Center Live. Now to today's program. June is always a pivotal month for democracy. And that has been especially true in the last several years, because that is the month in which the Supreme Court decides some of its most difficult and divisive and consequential cases. It is a pivotal moment when the court hands down decisions that have the potential to reshape the United States as we know it. Last year, in this month, we saw the court expand gun rights and restrict reproductive rights, and enter similarly consequential decisions with respect to racial justice and voting rights. This year, we've seen a surprise win for democracy and voting rights in Alabama. Last year was, according to many critics, including our guests, the most extreme Supreme Court term in decades. So we're going to talk about that and ask, what does this year bring? Many Americans are asking themselves, how did we get here? There's a new book, The Supermajority, How the Supreme Court Divided America by Michael Waldman, that tries to answer that very question. Michael is the president of the Brennan Center, and he served on the Presidential Commission on the Supreme Court of the United States that was convened by President Joe Biden. The book delves into the history of our nation's highest court and breaks down what reforms are necessary in order to bring balance back to the court and to our government. And we are very lucky to have Michael with us today for this conversation. Joining him, we also have Kareem Creighton, who recently joined the Brennan Center as Senior Director for Voting and Representation. He is a political scientist, a law professor, and an expert on redistricting and representation. In the surprising Supreme Court ruling earlier, Allen against Milligan, regarding voting rights in Alabama, Kareem has a unique insider's view because he served as counsel to Democrats in the legislature through Alabama's two most recent efforts to redraw their voting maps. So I can't wait to begin the conversation and hear their thoughts. Michael and Kareem, welcome.
Thank you.
Now, let's get to some questions. Michael, let me start with you. If you could go into a little bit of background from researching your book, have you found other Supreme Court terms that were as consequential as last year's and potentially this year's?
This is, in fact, an unusual and very consequential time in the Supreme Court. The court has its role in our system because we, the people, give it this much authority. The part of the Constitution that deals with the Supreme Court and the courts is only 1/10 the length of that dealing with Congress and the president, for example. And most of the time throughout the country's history, in fact, the court has tended to hug the middle. It's tended to reflect whatever the consensus is, good or bad, of the moment. But there have been a few times in the country's history in the past that resemble this moment where the court has overreached or been extreme or particularly activist, and there's been a fierce backlash, a fierce public response. That happened, for example, initially after the Dred Scott ruling in the 1850s, which said Congress could not bar slavery from the territories, and in fact that black people were unable to be citizens. And the response was so intense, among other things, it led to the rise of the Republican Party and the election of Abraham Lincoln and so many other things, including ultimately the abolition of slavery and the 14th Amendment, responding in that period of drama and turmoil. There was another period like that at the beginning of the 20th century, a time of industrialization and inequality, the Gilded Age. And the Supreme Court justices of that time felt their job was to stop government from taking action to protect workers, to protect women, public safety. And this is known to the lawyers as the Lochner era. But again, it was a fierce political debate and backlash. I learned in researching the book that Teddy Roosevelt's 1912 campaign, in this fabled election where he ran against his handpicked successor, and then Woodrow Wilson was the Democrat, and there was Eugene Debs, the socialist. Teddy Roosevelt's big issue was taking on the Supreme Court. And of course, that led all the way up to the fights between his cousin Franklin and the Supreme Court during the New Deal. And the third period where there was backlash and controversy around the court was the Warren Court and its aftermath. The one time the Supreme Court was sort of ahead of the country in protecting rights and promoting equality. I, of course, revere so many of the rulings of the Warren Court, and the Brennan Center is named after Justice Brennan, who was one of the leaders of that court. But there's no doubt that we are living in the backlash to this day, to that period of judicial activism. I think we're in a similar moment now with this very conservative supermajority and the first stirrings and more of a very strong public response and backlash. I think it'll help shape our politics going forward.
Great. Kareem, if I could ask you about the voting decision. But before getting there, I wanted to ask you about your work with the Alabama legislature and why you think this ruling caught so many of us in the voting rights and redistricting world by surprise.
Sure, thanks for the question. It's a real joy to be with you all this afternoon. I'm happy to talk about the work. Prior to joining the Brennan Center, I've had sort of different roles in voting rights space, but the one that we're talking about today really was work that I, as a consultant, did with a lot of different entities over the redistricting cycle, which included people who called and said, we think something bad's about to happen. Can you help us? And that was a call I was happy to take, among other places, from my folks in my home state in Alabama, no stranger to voting rights questions. And the House Democrats in particular knew that they had just finished a resolved voting map from the last time they got sued in court and the state lost. And now the question was, what do they do with redistricting in a way that, you know, now we're doing it for the first time, and at least in 2020, after having lost an important part of the Voting Rights Act, the pre-clearance process, how do we do this in a way that at least tries to get the supermajority of Republicans who control the legislature to comply with law? So the work was really one of trying to guide the members who probably were going to be outvoted if things were a straight party line vote to at least get the conversation about law into the record. And I would just say for law students listening and young lawyers, the key to all of this long before you get to the Supreme Court, which is an important part of the process, is to anticipate what the Supreme Court's going to be concerned about. And so my job was to really help guide the conversation so that we had a record that eventually found its way to the court. So why was I surprised? In short, the surprise was that Alabama and the Republicans in the legislature really paid no attention to existing law. They went forward, did not have much of a process at all, and essentially said, we really are perfectly fine if you take this thing to court. We're happy to litigate our arguments there, which of course suggested maybe they knew what the outcome was gonna be. And we could talk about the reasons why maybe they had some basis in belief that this would work that way. But essentially they crafted a map that totally reflected their own interests and totally ignored the concerns and interests brought up primarily by African-American voters in Alabama, but also the people that represented them in the state legislature. And unfortunately, I think even with a lot of money and a lot of lawyers supporting them, they didn't do the basic work that the law required them to do. And that's why, given all of that, we sort of wondered, well, maybe they know something about the court. We don't, about what their outcome would be. And the court did exactly the opposite of that. They rejected the invitation to basically rewrite Section 2 or eliminated it in its entirety. What they said was essentially, we're going to embrace the 40 years of district court, circuit court, and United States Supreme Court decisions that had understood Section 2 to be a valid exercise of congressional authority, and an application was absolutely appropriate to ban maps like the one Alabama had drawn that had, out of seven districts, only one of them where African Americans had a working majority or opportunity to elect a candidate, when in fact they could have had at least two districts. And so the message from the Supreme Court is, yeah, we're going to say to the state of Alabama, the legislature has to comply with the law as we've understood it. So that was the surprise.
Well, it certainly caught many of us off guard, pleasantly, but definitely caught us off guard. Because as you said, Alabama's briefing in the case really did seem like swinging for the fences, essentially telling the court, we're going to take a different path from the last 40 years of precedent about the Voting Rights Act, and so should you. So I think your surprise was common across across the legal world. If I could ask both of you, right now we seem to be at a boiling point for politicization. And I guess the question is, how did we get here? And in your opinion, when did this start?
I'll get us started. I mean, the Supreme Court is by its definition enmeshed in politics. We want it to be, and we want to believe that it is above that, beyond that, and that in some way it's a court. But we know also that it reflects the intense polarization in Congress that causes these folks to get confirmed, among other things, to the court. In recent decades, the conservatives in particular have focused a great deal on making sure that presidents appoint justices, have the chance to appoint justices who are conservative in their judicial and, I would say, even in their political philosophy. It's a really interesting anomaly in our system. As the country is moving in one direction, the court in some respects is veering in another. To give you an example of some of the kind of potential disconnect, this is an empirical point, not a partisan point. One party, the Democrats in this case, won the popular vote in seven of the last eight presidential elections. That's actually the longest winning streak for a political party in the history of the United States. But Republican presidents have appointed six of the nine justices. A lot of that is happenstance. Some of it is things like Mitch McConnell and the Senate not being willing to consider a nomination from President Obama his last year in office. So things have gotten more polarized, more partisan. The confirmations have become more intense. And as that happens, there's a greater and greater risk of public support for the court and the public credibility of the court draining away. Right now, in all the polls, it's at the lowest level of public trust in the court ever recorded. So that's a real risk and a worry for those of us who want a strong and independent judiciary.
Kareem?
Yeah, I you know, Michael wrote a great book on this, so I think his view is certainly supported by all the great episodes that he kind of catalogs. I would just add to it, just as an example, Brennan Center is named for Justice Brennan, and it's easy to forget Justice Brennan, known to be really the author of a lot of progressive decisions, was appointed by a Republican president. And so too was it the case that many of his colleagues during the Warren Court era. And I think one of the challenges now that we see is that, the appointees, the people that are usually promoted in this process, usually tend to have to match up ideologically with the people that appoint them. And they, early on, there's a conversation as to whether or not, all the way down on every issue, do people match up with their political preferences of the party of the president that's appointing them. I don't think that has always been the case. I think it has become an expectation of the process, either in the White House as the selections are made, or in the Senate as the confirmations proceed. But I think one of the challenges is really to the point of independence, finding people who, whatever their political backgrounds were to start, that they recognize that there's a national interest that they represent, and they have to work together, right? Nine people on a court to try to come up with answers that are very difficult, but that don't always follow what you might expect from, you know, a political party that has appointed, you know, whatever number of justices there are. That to me is the core issue.
I'm reminded briefly of when I was in law school and my federal courts professor would ask a question, do you think the decision would have been different if this particular justice were voting on the substantive issue in the Senate? And that was always his test for whether or not the decision was more judicial than it was political. And if you could answer it in the affirmative or the negative, you would have an answer to that underlying question. Michael, you talked a few minutes ago about backlash, historically moments in which the court has gotten to a point that provoked popular backlash. Historically, has that backlash led to change? And if so, how?
Absolutely. And on your Senate test, that's one of the reasons this voting rights ruling was such a surprise, because John Roberts not only helped lead the Supreme Court's series of decisions over the past decade undermining the Voting Rights Act, but as a young attorney, crusaded against the very provision of the Voting Rights Act passed by Congress that he then voted to uphold in this ruling. So that would be an example, a good example, I think, a positive example of that test. When there's been backlash, it's often been very political. It's led to changes in voting. It's led to new changes in how people are elected. It has led in part to the court reversing or changing its own approach. After FDR attempted to expand the court, the famous court packing fight, Roosevelt lost and it sort of blew apart the New Deal coalition. But as also was the case, the Supreme Court backed down and stopped trying to micromanage economic regulation. So in fact, the backlash had an impact there. What's striking right now is we're seeing a backlash in particular to the first full year term of the supermajority of the six very conservative justices that had its first full term ending last June. And in those last 3 days of that term, first there was the Bruin case, which was by far the most sweeping Second Amendment case in the country's history. Then the next day was the Dobbs ruling, which, as folks know, overturned Roe v. Wade, overturned Casey, and ended the protection, federal protection in the Constitution for abortion rights and reproductive rights that had been in place for half a century, and also potentially put at risk lots of other privacy rights in the Constitution. And then the third ruling on the final day was West Virginia versus EPA. It gets a little less attention than those other big dramatic cases, but it was the beginning of a significant assault by this court on the ability of regulatory agencies to act to protect the environment, in this case in climate change. They crammed decades of social change, I would argue, into those 3 days. And the backlash has come fast and furious. We saw it in many ballot initiatives about abortion rights around the country. We saw it in the midterm elections, which is noteworthy. You know, presidents' parties usually, as a law of political physics, they do badly in the midterm election. This was the best midterm election for the president's party in decades, in response to the Dobbs case and also concerns about democracy. And I think noteworthy, too, was a recent election in the Wisconsin Supreme Court. They elect their justices for the Supreme Court in Wisconsin, as most of the country does. And it's a very evenly divided state. And voters tend to divide pretty closely on these elections. It swung to an 11-point win for the more liberal candidate. Kareem is a political scientist. He can tell me if I'm all wet here, but that's pretty unusual. if replicated, that is an earthquake. So I think we're seeing a significant backlash. I don't see evidence that it's going away. One question is, will this electoral backlash, will this public opinion backlash have an impact on the court and its rulings and how courts rule?
So today is the 21st of June, and the term this year is coming to a close any day now. We've already seen some consequential decisions come from the court, and we're obviously expecting more before the end of the term. I'd really love to hear your thoughts, both of you, on what we have seen already in terms of opinions handed down, and also what we should expect or might expect in the coming weeks. And perhaps we could start with you, Kareem.
Sure. On the same general theme as things that surprised us, given the court's positioning in other cases, there was the recent decision out of Oklahoma on the Indian Child Welfare Act, where the court actually upholds existing law as we have understood it to operate to recognize the sovereignty of Native people. That was not necessarily what we thought was going to happen in, you know, a large number of cases, but not all. The court has not been particularly friendly to challenges where the rights of sovereign nations are pitted against either the rights of states or, for that matter, sometimes private individuals within those states. And this is one of those places where, like in the voting rights case, the Supreme Court really upheld existing interpretations of the federal law, but also recognized the constitutional positioning of sovereign nations to be respected. And that actually, again, may reflect the kind, in certain circumstances, of movement that the court is willing to make within its conservative majority to at least carve out space for existing understandings. And one last thing I'd say about the court in response, in connection to really what Michael said earlier, the court is indeed a small political institution. I think sometimes it ranges maybe into the partisan work, but here, I think political is inclusive of the idea of being responsive. And I think the public backlash and outcry of a lot of the decisions that the court made last term are being felt now. And so maybe the headlong rush to get rid of Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act, which if you read the dissent of Justice Thomas, sort of is a lament that, you know, we should have just gone all the way, represents at least the willingness of the court in limited circumstances to pull back from a full bore pursuit of what I think could be a hyper-partisan agenda. We don't know what else is coming in the court, but I just wanted to say there are places, not just in voting rights, where the court has at least zigged when we thought they might zag.
And I will bring a cloud to accompany the silver lining a little bit, in the sense that I think the Alabama case was a huge victory for voting rights and equal justice, and will lead not only to probably redrawing the maps in Alabama to have increased representation, but other states as well, with a real impact. But both that case and the Indian Child Welfare Act case were cases where the court chose not to undo well-considered and long-standing laws passed by Congress. And I think it's important that those of us who look at this court and how it's working, both not get overly hyped up all the time, but also not become so inured to this that we don't see that what they did was exactly what they ought to do, which is not undo laws that have been on the books for decades, just because they now have a different lineup of personnel. I do think that the upcoming cases, and I think the Voting Rights Act case, with which we're the most familiar, goes beyond that, because it will really help Voting Rights Act claimants seeking redress in the courts. And I think that's a significant signal to the lower courts. Some of the big cases coming up, of course, are the affirmative action cases, the independent state legislature claim. I won't call it a theory because that would give it too much weight, in Moore versus Harper, and a number of other cases where we're going to see, is it the case that there is a new tempered caution on the part of the conservatives, or was this the beginning of the month, and we'll, by the end of the month, we'll be rending our garments?
Let me just add briefly, connected to the Alabama case, because I certainly sit on the side of the street of cautious, very cautious optimism. It's important to know that even with the important win in Alabama, what it means for Black voters who were the plaintiffs in that case is that 2 years late, they're getting an answer that we all knew what was incorrect. That is, that the map was incorrect and illegal, and we knew what the law was in 2021. But what it has meant is that African-American voters, all voters in Alabama, had to vote on illegal maps. And that's strictly due to the court's exercise of what is known as the shadow docket, its ability to use procedure to upend or stay decisions that have been taken in the other courts of the federal system. But what that means is that there's real political impact on the voters who need representation. But of course, as we know, the House of Representatives is very, tightly divided. And so every seat actually matters as to who controls Congress, but also ultimately who moves policy. And so I just want to make sure I don't sit too much on the optimism side of the street. We're cautious about the optimism for sure.
So I want to move to questions, but before we do, just one question that came to mind as you were talking. This recent set of decisions and the ones that are likely to come, how do you think that that slate of decisions will affect the movement to change the court?
There's a considerable amount of energy, not just for responding with legislation, because the Congress could pass the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act, which actually had a majority of the Senate in the last cycle, but which was blocked by a filibuster to restore the Voting Rights Act. Congress can act legislatively. There can be responses through constitutional amendments and all kinds of other ways we can respond to misguided court rulings. But there's considerable new momentum for reform of the court itself. I think that that momentum will continue, even if people are breathing a sigh of relief in a sense that the rulings this term are not quite as out there as last term. Two areas that are of great immediate interest and intensity. One has to do with ethics. The Supreme Court, as you know, is the only court in the country without a binding ethics code. That's the kind of thing that all the other federal courts and state courts too are covered by. The idea is that nobody's so wise that they should be the judge in their own case. So there ought to be a binding ethics code. Congress can pass that, but the court could do it too. And obviously headlines every day, every minute suggest as to why that might be a good idea. The other thing that I think has increasing momentum is to introduce an 18-year term limit for Supreme Court justices, coupled with regular appointments. So presidential appointments can happen every 2 years. This is actually a very popular idea with left and right. It is rooted in the insight that nobody should have too much public power for too long. George Washington taught us that when he stepped down after two terms as president. I was on the Presidential Commission on the Supreme Court, as you mentioned. We heard lots of witnesses, dozens of witnesses from all across the political spectrum. For example, some were for court expansion, others were against it. Some were for an ethics code, others were against it. Over and over again, they said, oh, but I'm for term limits. It could be done by a constitutional amendment. We at the Brennan Center also think it could be done by statute. We've actually just put out a policy proposal to that effect. One way or the other, I think this is an idea whose time has come. I think there's a lot of momentum going forward.
So thank you. And why don't we turn to questions? One question, which is fresh off the front pages of the newspapers today. The question is, will news like the news today about Justice Alito prompt introduction of a code of ethics? So I don't know if one of you would like to give a little bit of the background for those who might not have followed the story that broke today.
Okay, for anyone who's been in a cave, I can do that. Yesterday, Justice Alito published an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal decrying an article that hadn't come out yet in ProPublica, the publication which also had had revelations about Justice Thomas and his entanglement with a conservative billionaire. Yesterday, the story ran in ProPublica, and what it showed was that Justice Alito received very luxurious travel from Paul Singer, a billionaire, early in his term, did not disclose it. But then Singer's cases were quite high profile and in front of the court, and Justice Alito did not recuse himself from hearing those cases. Having these cases had to do with Argentinian debt and his hedge fund. And they were covered quite widely at the time. And one of the issues there is that when Supreme Court justices hear cases, or they don't say why they're not recusing themselves, or are recusing themselves, and thus avoiding conflicts of interest. And in this particular case, there's a lot of entanglement where Justice Alito, in effect, in his op-ed, said, "Well, we barely knew each other. we were good friends, so it was a gift from a friend. But then I didn't have to recuse myself because I barely knew the guy." So this kind of thing, and there's every reason to think there's more like this. We can't assume these are the only two examples. And the huffing and puffing in response to it, in the pre-buttal in the Wall Street Journal op-ed page, suggests that, again, there's going to be more and more pressure from the Senate Judiciary Committee and others to do something about this. It puts a lot of pressure not just on Congress to act, but John Roberts too, who does seem to care about the institutional credibility of the court. Every time something like this happens, it puts a big dent in that credibility, I think.
100% agree. I would just add, the news would have been enough if the first sentence Michael offered were the story. That is, Justice of the Supreme Court, sitting justice, publishes an op-ed about himself in the Wall Street Journal. That is pretty rare. And to do it about a matter of ethics is kind of odd. And I mean, if you haven't read it, it's worth looking at, where, again, the defense is, well, there was an empty seat on a plane and it was, it had to be sat in by somebody. That doesn't seem to be a sufficient standard of what's ethical for any judge. And that's the other point to note, that, no other judge in the United States, other than those sitting on the Supreme Court, could have done this and gotten away with it. There would be convenings in Congress to address their fitness to sit on the bench. But I totally agree. Ultimately, this sits at the chair of the Chief Justice in the management of the court, but ultimately, all of us. And I do think the conversation about what we want out of our Supreme Court is something that we should demand out of Congress to address. And if the court doesn't itself want to create its own ethical rule that is actually binding, then we should demand that out of Congress and legislation, before, in addition to the other structural questions that I think Michael's book does a really good job of describing.
So, Kareem, you mentioned Congress, and I guess one question that's in the chat is, how much discussion is actually occurring in Congress regarding reforms to the Supreme Court? Now, I know that there have recently been hearings and statements by members in both houses about ethics issues and potentially clarifying what ethics rules apply to the court. But if either of you could comment on other discussions, including the types of more far-reaching structural changes that Michael, you had previewed a few minutes ago.
Michael, you want to start?
I can give it a start. I mean, my basic broad answer would be not enough. it is beginning, but it tends to sometimes fall down the list of priorities, especially interestingly in the past, up until now, among Democrats. Conservatives and Republicans for decades have understood the importance of these issues, have understood the importance of these nominations, have understood the importance of the court. There's moves to try to investigate some of the ethics issues here. The earlier controversy involving Harlan Crow and Clarence Thomas, where he basically seems to have been subsidizing Justice Thomas's lifestyle without it being disclosed, including buying his mother's house and renovating it, and things that would be sort of familiar to the denizens of some of the seedier precincts of state legislatures and state capitals. There's momentum to investigate those things, but I think that this is the kind of thing where ultimately there needs to be, if at all possible, bipartisan approach. There are many Republicans as well as Democrats who've supported and term limits, for example. Among them, John Roberts has actually called for term limits for Supreme Court justices. But I think one way or the other, the Democrats now need to shake off the kind of hazy reverence for the court, which sometimes seems to be an after effect still to this day of the Warren Court. Understand this is a political institution that checks and balances go both ways, and that they have a duty and a political duty too to hold this branch of government accountable.
I'd only add briefly, we are, of course, in the middle of a gridlocked Congress. That is, they're divided. You know, the House is controlled by Republicans, the Senate Democrats, but of course, the margins are narrow there too. And Michael's absolutely right about the sort of plethora of issues that have sort of taken over, I think, the agendas of everybody else, thinking about all the other emergencies that we're dealing with. But this issue of the court and its ethics and its ability to do its job in a fair way, I think, is becoming more and more central to every other conversation. And I think that as we start looking at, you know, how, for example, Senator Whitehouse does a pretty good job consistently of talking about the ethical problems, not just of people once they get on the court, but the effort to get people to the court. I think there's going to be more discussion about the structural changes that, you know, can hopefully once and for all solve this. The public opinion on the Supreme Court now is at an all-time low. It's, you know, rivaling Congress, and nobody tends to like Congress in these polls. So I think a lot of people are watching it, and I think as more and more of these big questions get presented to the court, I think people are now going to start expecting judges to look more like judges.
Michael, you had touched on a number of proposals, including term limits. And I know that one variant would be to have justices serve on the court for a period of time and then, in effect, rotate back into or down into the Court of Appeals so they would remain members of the federal judiciary, just not on the Supreme Court. And obviously, any type of change could be done through a constitutional amendment, but you suggested that perhaps that's not necessary. This tees up a question in the chat, which is, would it pass constitutional muster to rotate justices through the Supreme Court and courts of appeals? And I this is the right time, I guess, to ask you to give a little bit of analysis on that idea.
So it's a good question. Congress has great power to address the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court and the other federal courts. It first of all, it does have the power to expand or shrink the size of the court, but it has the power to deal with jurisdiction. And another version of that is the idea that justices would become senior justices after 18 years. In the past, Congress has enacted and the courts have upheld the idea that someone could stay on the bench, serve their lifetime term, but have a different role after a certain period of time. And we think these things could be done by statute. People say, well, but then wouldn't it all go back to the Supreme Court to decide if it were constitutional? And that's a fair question. My own view, maybe wrongly, is that if it were the case that the public elects Congress, that Congress somehow overcomes its own inertia and paralysis and passes something like an 18-year term limit with the senior justice model, for example, and it goes to the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court strikes it down as unconstitutional, that you would get a pretty strong public response and a constitutional amendment passed pretty fast. That kind of reaction has happened too. So I don't think that it's a good idea to hold back on the kinds of reforms that are needed and needed to be pushed and discussed just because someday the people who need the reform might not like it. That may be actually an argument as to why it's important to do it.
And one just thing to add about that is how common this is to have limited terms on a constitutional court. Worldwide, that is the norm in modern democracies. I clerked on a court in South Africa, one of the most modern of constitutions that built into its system a limited term. And there are, you know, really great judges who I'm sure could continue to do their job long afterwards. But the important piece was to make sure that With these limits, we give greater opportunity to more people who have a fresh perspective on the law. And that, as Michael said in his book, that we don't accord any person or persons with unchecked power. We don't want the danger of that. And I think it is overall a very elegant solution that he offers. I asked a lot of questions when I first read the book, and I feel like it did a really great job of at least giving us an answer that actually is within our reach if we're willing to pressure Congress to do it.
And I'll note also that the state Supreme Courts, all but one, have either a term limit or a retirement age. The answer is Rhode Island, by the way, in case anyone wants to know what the state is.
I was racking my brain trying to think, that's going to show up on Jeopardy one day, I know. There's a question in the chat asking about impeachment or the recall of a Supreme Court justice. And I guess one question is, have we ever actually successfully impeached and removed a Supreme Court justice? And is that a potential, perhaps drastic, route if push comes to shove?
Well, I can start with a little comment to say, you know, there were efforts in the past. I think Salmon Chase probably came the closest, but I don't think that was successful. And I think we probably have, in a process, it should be said, is pretty similar to impeaching a president of the United States. And if we look at that as a template, we have a few recent examples of that suggest that there are going to be some challenges given the polarized nature of our Congress. So addressing that matter might be a challenge outside of, you know, something that's much more of a structural shift.
And I think just as with the presidency, impeachment has loomed really large as this incredibly powerful sanction. But when it starts to get used, because it doesn't result in the actual removal of the person, even if they're well-deserving of removal, it loses a lot of its oomph. The one other more recent time, maybe with some relevance for now, where impeachment was a real thing for a Supreme Court justice was the beginnings of an impeachment investigation of Abe Fortas, who was one of the justices in the 1960s, who was also receiving gifts from a wealthy individual. And in that case, felt the sting of potential impeachment proceedings was so great, the shame was so great that he resigned. We saw with the presidency, there have now been three failed impeachments in the last 25 years. It has lost a lot of its sting as a sanction. I think some of these things like term limits or ethics codes or other structural reforms are longer term necessary guardrails. We can't simply wait for the kind of case by case effect of impeachment, though that should be part of it.
As just an historical matter, has there been a movement in the past for either term limits or some other structural change to the court that got beyond the sort of fantasy stage? Michael,
in the progressive era, there was a lot of ferment. There were proposals for term limits. There were proposals, Teddy Roosevelt's proposal, which we would, I think, find pretty wild, was that when the courts made a constitutional ruling, there could be a ballot measure to overturn it. There were other things like that, but they've not focused like this. Again, we all know that Franklin Roosevelt pushed to expand the Supreme Court at a time when the conflict was really intense in the 1930s. It was the Depression. A third of the country was unemployed. The Supreme Court of its time was very conservative. They were called the Nine Old Men. They struck down much of the first New Deal, and were getting ready to go after Social Security and to go after the labor laws, really high stakes and popular things. Now, it's important to remember, FDR had just won the biggest electoral landslide that anybody had won. And 70% of the Senate was in his own party. But it turned out that proposal triggered a response from a kind of a latent public sentiment about the court. And so I think any reforms any of us talk about have to really be careful in understanding what will look illegitimate to the public, even if the public thinks what the court is doing right now is illegitimate too.
Well, that is a, I mean, historically, I think that has been the sword and shield, that the court has tended to want to maintain its sense of public legitimacy in the eyes of the public, while at the same time, efforts to change or reform the court have kept that top of mind too. A couple other questions in the chat that I wanted to put to you. Kareem, maybe you could start with this one. How does Milligan apply in other redistricting cases? So, you know, Milligan, again, a surprise to many, but will it have farther reaching effects in current or future redistricting cases?
Absolutely, and it's an important question. Obviously, it has immediately had impact on Alabama. That is, in a few weeks, they're supposed to be redrawing their maps. There are other cases that actually have been pursued on the same general theory. This wasn't apparently just what the Republicans in the legislature in Alabama did, but in Georgia and Louisiana, there's pending litigation about the failure to draw additional seats as well that reflect political opportunity for African Americans. And those cases now have a bit more wind at the sails because the court has basically said, yeah, we actually believe the application of Section 2 is still in effect and you should apply the law accordingly. So Louisiana is likely soon to be ordered to craft a new congressional district, as is Georgia at the congressional level, but also recognize that, you know, in addition to congressional district drawing, which of course I know has a lot of attention, there are districts that go from state legislative seats all the way down to the local city council seats. And there are probably places out there where either there's pending litigation or existing discussions about whether or not more could be done. And the fact that conversations about Section 2 now have a clear statement from the Supreme Court showing its legitimacy, embracing its traditional approach, definitely is a positive move. So I think a lot of jurisdictions that may not necessarily be in litigation are going to be looking at their maps again, making certain that they've done all that they can to represent political opportunity for minority groups, not just African Americans, but across the slate.
Another question in the chat, Michael, maybe you can start out by tackling this one. Does the court ever respond to public outcry?
They say they don't, and the louder they say it, the more you know they do. And there's quite a bit of scholarly evidence over many, many, many years, Barry Friedman of NYU, among others, writing about this at length, that the Supreme Court does respond to public opinion and public outcry. I would say that an example within the past 15 years was after Citizens United in 2010, which was one of those rulings on democracy where I think the court went way, way in the wrong direction. There was a significant outcry. The House of Representatives passed a motion for a constitutional amendment. And that turmoil back then, this was in 2010, helped create the atmosphere where John Roberts understood that he needed to try to cast a vote. He had originally voted to overturn the Affordable Care Act in its entirety. But he realized he needed to find a way to actually switch his vote and try to save the law. So there are times when the court does respond to these things. I guess I would say two things in addition to that. Not everybody does. Last term, the court was very loud in saying, well, in earlier eras, they listened to public opinion. In earlier eras, for example, in the Casey case, they understood that there was a lot of reliance on the right to reproductive choice and that it would be really disruptive and really unpopular to undo it. And they listened to that back when Sandra Day O'Connor was writing the opinions. Well, we don't do that anymore. We think that's crass and unprincipled. So at least many of the current very conservative justices say anyway that they're not listening to public opinion in that way. And I think also it sort of depends on the issue. I think that when there are these very big, very political issues, they're making a calculus, but I think there are times when they think it's time to rip the Band-Aid off and take the heat. But we have this power, we're going to use it.
Yeah. And to that, I'd only add, you know, if you see Justice Alito in speeches and in op-eds, responding to things that aren't even yet out. It's quite clear, at least some, as Michael mentioned, some justices are following this closely. How it plays out in their work, I think, is a little harder to kind of draw a point A to B line, but I think it's quite clear as they are, and certainly the Chief Justice, as he's thinking about what the legacy of the Roberts era is, he's certainly attuned to how, among other things, the decisions that the court makes and also the personnel, like how they talk about the work of the court, is perceived in the public. So I think all of those ways are, and in addition to what Michael said, is, you know, exactly the kind of stuff that is kind of what courts have always done. I think this court is no different in that respect.
There was a question earlier in the chat asking about broadcasting of arguments at the court. And of course, at one time, the court didn't broadcast anything. It would then put out transcripts later on. Then after a couple of weeks, put out the recordings of oral arguments. And then in more recent years, prompted by the pandemic, but perhaps prompted by a felt need to be more open and engaged with the public, the court has, to my surprise at least, been much more open and receptive to live streaming their arguments, which is not something I ever thought was going to be a likely outcome. Still no TV, still no video, but audio is there.
I'll note one interesting exception to that. It has been noteworthy, and it hasn't led to people grandstanding, you know, for the public in their arguments, or the justices for that matter. The one exception to that, though, was last year. They heard the arguments in person and live streamed, but they did not release the arguments the traditional way of having them read from the bench. They just put a PDF up on the website. That means there's no tape of Justice Alito saying, "We hereby overturn Roe v. Wade," for example, or of the dissenters decrying it. And I have to wonder whether that was just an effort to hide the ball, because there was no public health rationale, say COVID, for that. And I do understand they've come back in person again to be doing these things, but that was pretty noteworthy gap last year.
And I should note, by the way, that you can find arguments and also hand downs and oral dissents going back to the 1950s. Actually, that is a practice the court has adhered to pretty strictly for a very, very, very long time. So I hadn't focused on that. We have a few minutes left, and I wanted to give our panelists time to highlight things that maybe we haven't gotten to that are important. And so my last question is, if you could tell the audience one thing to walk away with this afternoon, what would it be? And it could be about the structure of the court, it could be about reform efforts, it could be about a particular judicial decision that has been decided or that is likely to come down soon. So let me start with you, Kareem.
So I think the one thing I would say is, drawing on a theme I mentioned earlier, which is really what the court is. I think sometimes in law talk, we give the impression that the court is this, you know, revered institution of people who have somehow knowledge that we don't. And obviously they do some things that we don't see. We see the product of their work, but they're people. And they're people who come to the job with different experiences. And in my point of view, we should hold them accountable for the decisions that they take. And that means both recognizing that these people can be imperfect. That means that they can, you know, miss things that, you know, you and I or experts in the field might be, you know, shouting to the, you know, to the top of their lungs about what the court needs to do. My point simply is to say, yes, one, they are political institutions that listen to public opinion, but two, that we have, I think, an obligation to be managers of our Constitution and the court that's interpreted them. And what does that mean? I think in part that means being unafraid to think creatively about how to make the court better. Don't leave it to the justices themselves to do it, but to demand that out of Congress. But also, when we see issues that we, you know, disagree with, that doesn't end the story. Yes, we have to respect the law that's made that this court creates, but there's still the work after that. And so, you know, I just would say, whatever happens for the remainder of this term, let's not lose hope and let's not lose directive and passion to continue to work for the issues that we care the most about. The court, you know, the fight of the court can sometimes be misleading. It is important to get people in there that are representative and thoughtful, but they're one part of a big puzzle that is our democracy. And I think we have to do what we can as citizens to maintain it. And that means sometimes demanding change in how the court works. And I really appreciate Michael for putting this great book together to describe one great way to make it happen.
Michael, thank you. One takeaway for the audience today.
I emphatically agree with what Kareem has said. These are government officials with a lifetime tenure, but government officials. They wear robes, but they're not wizards or religious figures divining the past. It's up to all of us to hold them accountable, to shout about it, to debate it, to talk about it as we are now, to vote about it, to ask people running for office, asking for our votes, what are you going to do? What is your view of the Constitution? What are you going to do to reform the court? If this can move to the center of public debate, as it should, then that's what gives me hope, and that's what I hope people take away from this.
Well, I think this has been a fantastic discussion. We have tackled some difficult and sensitive topics. And we've also talked through a number of historical perspectives about where the court is today and where it may well be going in the light of what might be a shift, even if a slight shift, in the speed and perhaps direction that the current majority of the court is willing to take it. So I want to thank Michael and Kareem for this phenomenal discussion. It has been substantive and provocative. And I want to thank as well our audience for participating. So thank you for all of your questions as well. I wish we had the time to answer all of them. But let me close there. Again, my name is Troy McKenzie. I'm Dean of NYU School of Law. Thank you all for coming and participating in this wonderful event today.
Thank you.